بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، we have moved to verse number 25 of Surah Al-Kahf, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after mentioning the difference of opinion about their quantity, He then mentions the difference of opinion about how long they stayed. And here is really the i'jaz, or the miracle of the Qur'an, that the people who asked about the cave and the Ashab al-Kahf were themselves ignorant about their quantity and their number. And they wanted to challenge the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to see if he knew anything about the people of the cave. Not only did the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala respond to who the people of the cave were, He told the Ahli Kitab that these are your opinions. You said they're five, you said they're seven, you said they're three. And he told them the opinions about their number of years that they lived. And then he resolved their own difference of opinion. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing the perfection of His knowledge, that you dare challenge me about my knowledge, let me tell you even what you do not know. And so Allah says, they stayed in their cave for 300 years, and some of them, they added 9. Some of them added 9 to get 309. And some of our scholars have pointed out that 300 years in the Gregorian calendar is 309 in the lunar calendar. And this clearly shows us again that the precision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is a knowledge that the average Arab would not know at the time, to convert number of solar years into lunar years. Because 300 solar years is exactly 309 lunar years. So Allah said, they stayed in their cave for 300 years. Some of them added 9, and they're both exactly the same, because 300 solar years is 309 lunar years. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah knows how long they stayed. And this is because the Ahli Kitab, as I said 2 days ago, if you go back to the story of the seven sleepers of Ephesus, the person who wrote the story, the monk who wrote the story, he actually said 370 years. So there's a controversy even within their own Ahli Kitab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah knows how long they stayed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has complete knowledge of everything in the heavens and earth. أبصر به وأسمع. And this is for the Arabs, this is صيغه التعجب, يعني ما اسمعه وما ابصره. Be amazed at Allah's sight and Allah's hearing. ابصر به واسمع. Be amazed at Allah's seeing and be amazed at Allah's hearing. Allah sees all and Allah hears all, and they have no one they can turn to for protection besides Him, and none share the right of power, the right of legislation, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the point of this ayah is, Allah is telling the Ahli Kitab and the Quraysh, the fact that I know so much about the people of the cave, it demonstrates that only Allah is Allamul Ghuyub. Only Allah is truly divine. Only Allah is worthy of worship. And if Allah is that powerful, then how can you turn to other than Allah for your needs? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, this is now the story of the Ashab al-Kahf is finished. The people of the cave is finished. And then two points are mentioned. Both of these points go back to the main benefit from the cave, from the people of the cave. Allah tells us how the people of the cave were saved, and then He derives two benefits for us when we need to be saved as well. He already tells us to turn to Him. What else can we do? Number one, وَاتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ كِتَابِ رَبِّكَ. Recite what has been revealed to you of the book of your Lord. Scholars say, just like Allah protected the people of the cave through the cave, then the story of the cave finishes. The very next verse, when you're in a difficult situation, recite the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ كِتَابِ رَبِّكَ. So the book will be your protection. The book will shelter you like the cave sheltered them. Just as soon as the story of the cave finishes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet ﷺ, you need to recite the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's an indication, our protection, our saving, our metaphorical cave will be by reciting the book of Allah. And this is exactly what our Prophet ﷺ did when he was on the hijrah. What did he do? He recited the Quran, and it blinded the Quraysh. Literally blinded the Quraysh. And there are many other instances of the Prophet ﷺ reciting citing the Quran to seek the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, لا مبدل لكلماته ولن تجد من دونه ملتحدا. Nothing will change the speech of Allah. Unlike the stories of Ahli Kitab, they keep on changing. Some said 3, some said 5, some said 7, some said this, some said that. As for the speech of Allah, nothing changes. Fables grow, legends change. The speech of Allah never changes. And therefore, you will never find a protector other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first point. When you're in trouble, turn to the Quran. Turn to the Quran for protection. Another point that will benefit from the people of the cave, have good companionship. Because the people of the cave had a group. They weren't single. They were with a group of people. And believers have help from the other believers. They seek help after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from their brethren. So our Prophet is told, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِ. Be patient in staying with those who are making dua to Allah in the mornings and in the evenings. Now, it is said that an incident happened before this verse came down. And that is that Umayyah ibn Khalaf and some of the leaders of the Quraysh, they gave a ultimatum to the Prophet ﷺ. They said, if you get rid of Bilal and Abu Dharr and Ibn Mas'ud, and these were all from their perspective the low class, if you get rid of these second class citizens, we will then join you. If you get rid of the low of the society, because we don't want the people to say that we are associating with these riffraff, with these lowly people. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed multiple verses. This is one of them. And there's verses in An'am and other verses that have the same motif. And this is one of them. That the Prophet ﷺ is warned against ever flirting with this idea. And in this verse he is told, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ. Be patient. No matter at whatever cost, people ridicule you. People make fun of you. Even maybe some of the Sahaba might tax you in your patience. You need to be patient with them. With who? Those who make dua to Allah, يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ, in the morning and in the evening, which means constantly. They're always praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they only seek Allah's pleasure. وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. Don't even move your gaze beyond this batch. Don't even look at the other batch. Don't even be swayed by looking at the other batch. Stick your gaze towards the quality and don't look at the quantity. Don't look at the finery. Don't look at the prestige. Look at the iman and taqwa and keep your eyes fixed at this group of people. وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. In case you might want the beauty of this world. Now here's a point here, and it's a very important point, and you will benefit from this point throughout the Quran. A lot of times, brothers and sisters, we read the Quran and we see something addressed directly to the Prophet ﷺ. And we don't understand that why would Allah say this to the Prophet ﷺ when we know he could never be guilty of this crime. So, for example, one verse says that if he dares, invents a lie against us. But we know the Prophet ﷺ is never going to invent a lie. Another verse says, O Messenger, if you are in doubt as to what we have revealed to you, then go ask the people of the book. وَإِنْ كُنْتَ فِي شَكِّ مِمَّا أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ فَاسْأَلِ الَّذِينَ يَقْرَؤُونَ مِنْ كِتَابٍ قَبْلِكَ. And yet we know the Prophet was never in doubt. Yet the Quran seems to address him about a possibility that we know he could never have. And the average person who reads these types of verses gets confused. For example, in this verse, can we say that the Prophet ﷺ was tempted by the zina of the Quraysh, that he wanted the prestige of the Quraysh and he wanted to get rid of Bilal? No, this never happened. But sometimes, and this is a manner of eloquence, the Prophet ﷺ is addressed and the addressees are us through him and not him. The Prophet ﷺ is addressed directly, but the real intent of the verse is us. And this is a rhetoric, this is a device of eloquence that we need to understand. That many times in the Quran, when the Prophet is addressed, sometimes he is addressed directly. That's also obviously very common. Allah intends him. But sometimes he is addressed and we are the intended audience. Not him. He is just being used to get the message to us. And this is an example over here. That the Prophet was never persuaded to get rid of Bilal or Ibn Mas'ud. These were the earliest converts. These were the ones who were the stalwarts of the faith. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us the message through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Don't be deceived by the finery, by the fine fabrics, by the zina, the outer appearance. Make sure you stick with the quality. And that is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you. And that's what our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that إِنَّمَا تُنصَرُونَ بِضُعَفَائِكُمْ. Allah will help you, not through your mighty, but through your meek. إِنَّمَا تُنصَرُونَ بِضُعَفَائِكُمْ. Your du'afa, Allah's nasr will come because of them. Because Allah is qawi and Allah is aziz. And He will never allow the mighty to trample over the weak unjustly. So our Prophet is being told, and of course we are the ones who need to listen. He was never persuaded. The Prophet is being told, don't be deceived by their finery. Stick with the quality of people. وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. And do not follow that group whose hearts we have made blind, whose hearts we have covered up to our dhikr. The two groups are so different. One group is making dua morning and evening. The other group cannot even remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the contrast between the two. The first group, يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِي. يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ. Always dhikr, always dua, always Quran. The other group, they don't even remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do? وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ. They do whatever they desire to do. They follow their hawa. And of course, this person, وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. This person will be completely lost, completely in neglect. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, after answering the challenge of the Quraysh, you wanted to know the people of the cave? I told you. Now what are you going to do? وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. You wanted evidence? Here it is. You wanted proof? It's right in front of you. You challenged me? I answered the challenge. Now what are you going to do? The truth is from your Lord. If you want to accept it, then feel free to do so. Whoever wants to reject it, you may do so now. But what will happen? Of course, here now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, this is a very important verse, فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. And this proves that we as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe in a type of free will, not ultimate free will. We believe in a type of free will, that we are not robots. We are not completely majboor, is the Arabic word. This is not true. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us an element of free will, even though that free will, of course, is controlled by Allah's Qadr, because nothing happens without His Qadr. And there are verses in the Quran that affirm free will, and there are verses that affirm Allah's complete control over the creation, and both of these verses go hand in hand, and this is Sunni doctrine. In contrast to the extremist groups, one group said, Allah controls us like robots and we are like leaves in the wind, and this is false. Another group said, Allah has no control over us and we can do as we please, and this too is kufr and false. Ahl Sunnah is in the middle, and the simple way of phrasing this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a will, but Allah's will is above our will. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَسْتَقِيمُ. Whoever wants to will find guidance. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. But you will not want to find guidance unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed that guidance for you. So this ayah says, here is the evidence you wanted. You want to believe it? Go ahead. You want to reject it? Go ahead. Then there are threats and punishments. And of course, it is very common in the Quran. Never does Allah threaten except that He also promises His rewards. Never does Allah talk about His adab except that He also talks about His rahmah. And this is the way of Islam. This is the logical way. This is the way that makes sense. The carrot and the stick. We need to be frightened and we also need to be encouraged. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions here the punishments of the fire of hell. That those who reject, after all of this, we have prepared for them a fire that will envelope them. And if they want water, they will be given water like oil. It will make their faces even more burnt. بِئْسَ الشَّرَابُ وَسَاءَتْ مُرْتَفَقًا. What an evil drink that they're drinking, and what an evil place to live. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rewards of Jannah. Those who believe and those who do good, we will never cause their deeds to go to waste. As for them, they will have جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. They will have gardens under which rivers flow. They will be wearing bracelets. They're going to be having sundus and istabrak, which are both types of silk. And they are going to be reclining on couches. نِعْمَ الثَّوَابُ وَحَسُنَتْ مُرْتَفَقَ. In contrast to بِئْسَ الشَّرَابُ وَسَاءَتْ مُرْتَفَقَ. There's a contrast here. بِئْسَ and نِعْمَ. حَسُنَتْ and سَاءَتْ مُرْتَفَقَ. Now, the punishments of hell and the rewards of Jannah are a constant motif of the Quran. And I wanted to just give one brief point about this, because this is a very common philosophical problem. We get asked all the time by non-Muslims, and frankly, some of us as well, shaitan comes and gives us doubts. Shaitan comes and says to us, why is the punishment so severe? Why is the adab so much jahannam and nar and oil and water boiling? I mean, why can't Allah just forgive and we all just forget everything about it? And this is what many religions criticize Islam for. And they also criticize Islam for the paradise, sensual paradise, pleasures, jannat and gardens and rivers and hur and all of these things. So they criticize the strictness of Jahannam or the adab of Jahannam, and they criticize the pleasures of Jannah, and they say, what type of religion is this? And frankly, some of us as well, shaitan comes and brings these ideas into our minds. Now again, much can be said and the khatira time is limited. I just wanted to give one small point on each of these. As for the punishments, then a hadith in Sahih Muslim explains some of the wisdom of that punishment. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask one of the people who's being punished, and in one version, the least of those who are being punished in Adabu Jahannam, the least of them. Allah will ask him, if I were to allow you to get rid of all of this punishment by ransoming yourself off with all that you owned, even your children and all of your wealth, would you do this? And the man will say, of course, I will even give my children, I will give my wealth to get out of this punishment. Then Allah will say, but what I asked you was much less than this. All that I asked was that you worship me and don't do shirk with me. This was all that I asked. فَأَبَيْتَ إِلَّا أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي. But you still insisted on worshipping false gods besides me. Now, this gives us some of the wisdoms of the harsh punishment. Let me give an example so that we understand. Suppose your mother asks you for water. You're in the kitchen. She says, give me some water. And you say, no, I'm not going to give you water. Nobody's going to say, it's no big deal, you said no, it's just a glass of water. Everybody will say, she's your mother, how dare you say no to her? وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah has the perfect example. If your mother has so much right over you, that you not giving her a glass of water, even if it's just a glass, people will say, how dare you not answer that call? How about the one who gave you your mother and her love and your life and everything and all that Allah wanted in return, and he doesn't need it. But this is the point of this life. You acknowledge him and you don't worship others besides him. That's all that Allah wanted. And Allah set up the evidences, our intellect and the Quran and the Prophet and our fitrah. Everything is telling us there is one God, we should worship him. But we insist on living like animals. We turn away from the intellect. We turn away from our nature. We turn away from the Quran. And we live like baha'im, as Allah says. إِنْهُمْ إِلَّا كَالْأَنْعَامِ. They're living like cattle. بَلْهُمْ أَضَلْ. They're worse than cattle. If we insist on rejecting all of these, then the punishment makes sense. After all that Allah has given us. And as for the rewards of Jannah, then no doubt many of the rewards are a physical nature. But two points here. Firstly, there are rewards that are other than physical, and these are bigger and better. And the biggest reward of Jannah is to have that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to look at Allah and to hear the speech of Allah. And these are not the physical pleasures of this world. The greatest pleasures are not the physical pleasures of Jannah. Also, there are pleasures beyond the physical. As Allah says, لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا. They will have whatever they want. وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. We have more than this. وَلَهُمْ مَا يَدَّعُونَ. They will have whatever they want. So for some people, they will want things that are other than physical, and they will get those things. And the hadith, the famous hadith of the man who came to the Prophet and said, O Messenger of Allah, I love to cultivate. I want to plant seeds and I want to cultivate and I want to, you know, let the seeds grow. Will Allah allow me to grow plants in Jannah? So the Prophet ﷺ described beautifully, yes, Allah will allow you to plant the seed and the seed will be the biggest and you will pluck the fruits right then and there. At which one of the Bedouins said, O Messenger of Allah, this guy who asked the question, he must be from one of the Ansar because wallahi we hate to plant. We don't want planting in Jannah. And I can sympathize with the Bedouin when it comes to this wonder guard. I don't have any green thumb, I don't have much enjoyment in the backyard. But some of you have enjoyment there. So what is the point of this hadith? He wanted something that's not mentioned in the Quran. Right? That's his joy. The point is, Allah is telling us generic joys. Joys that, frankly, and listen to this carefully, let me be very explicit here. Wallahi, they can mock as much as they want the images of the Quran. They can mock it as much as they want. But their human nature cannot contradict the way Allah created them. When Allah gives them wealth and status, how do they build their own mansions and palaces? Jannatin tajri min tahtiha al-anhar. They have their swimming pools, their jacuzzis, they have their shrubbery and their greenery, and they also have the equivalent of hurun in, which we're not going to talk about here, but they have all of this, right? This is what they want. You cannot deny human nature. When they have that power and their wealth, how do they enjoy this dunya? Exactly like what Allah is describing Jannah. Because you cannot go against your human nature, even if you intellectualize it, even if you pretend you're sophisticated. What is the reality? Every person of wealth, they build their own little Jannat in tajri min tahtiha al-anhar. They build their own equivalent. It is ingrained in us that water and greenery and large buildings, this is what we like. And we want our houses to be like this. So Allah speaks to us in a language, wallahi, every one of us, we sympathize with and understand. Every one of us. But the point is, Jannah is more than this. Yes, this is there. وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. We have much more than this. So, let us not feel embarrassed about the descriptions of Jannah. We all want it. Muslim and Kafir, they want this thing. And there's much more than this. And as for the punishments of Jahannam, well, Allah is Aziz and Allah is Hakim. And Allah only required from us that we acknowledge Him and worship Him. And if somebody insists on turning away from everything, well then, he deserves that which is coming to him. And with this, inshallah, we conclude with the story of Ashab al-Kahf. Tomorrow we'll start with the second story, and that is the story of the two gardens. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.